Back in my early 20s, I had this boss, and I'm not even kidding, this guy never gave a compliment, never said a word of praise. Myself and my colleagues were well aware of this, and we'd even talk about it sometimes. Well, our boss went off to a seminar, and apparently he learned that if you're going to give some kind of a critical piece of feedback, you always want to start with a positive. So he took that skill back with him to the workplace, although he thought he was being super clever, and he would separate the praise from the criticism by several hours, actually. So yeah, the day came that one of my colleagues came in. He was a little bit late, and he says to us, "Oh man, I got a compliment this morning." And we're like, "Oh, I'm so sorry." And sure enough, about 3 or 4 hours later, he got called into the office and got his butt chewed.
Ooh, rough.
Mm-hmm.
This sounds like a stupid question.
Probably is, because, yeah, go ahead. Skilled managers equals high morale, which equals all that cool stuff that you cannot pay for and you can't punish for.
When you close off that feedback channel, you are not going to be able to hear the truth.
In the first microseconds, your brain can't tell the difference between physical danger and what we call social danger.
I mean, I'm pissed off at you.
Oh, me, specifically?
Well, you know, just because you're my boss and all.
Employees tend to get promoted until they reach their level of incompetence. Go forward and don't suck.
Are you typing why we're trying to record a podcast?
Yeah, hold on, buddy. I want to get this stuff done, and you go ahead and start your piece.
Hold on 1 second here.
Yeah.
You do realize that this podcast is basically a conversation, right?
Right.
We're having a conversation. So
right.
Just stop typing for a second if you don't mind.
All right.
When you type while we're trying to have a conversation and record a podcast, it distracts me.
Okay.
And so I'm not able to fully engage with what we're doing here.
Okay.
So I think it would be helpful if you could just, unless the world's going to come crashing down if you don't check your email in the next hour or so, if you could just put that away and we can just have a face-to-face, genuine conversation. What do you think about that?
Yeah, you're right. All right, dude, you're right. Let me close this up. All right, let's go.
Criticism, like rain, should be gentle enough to nourish a man's growth without destroying his roots, said one old white guy at one point in history.
That's really well put. Have you been recording this whole time?
I have.
Okay. All right. Here we
Mike.
Go. Yes, son.
What are we going to talk about today?
Well, apparently we're talking about feedback. So I just got my ass chewed.
Sorry about that. I actually thought that was fairly well delivered in terms of giving good feedback.
No,
I would like your feedback on my feedback at some point.
It was actually really good. Just as a little bit of a preview here, you got the B, you got the I, and you got the R. And we'll talk about what that means in a little bit. But yeah, you did it really well.
Well, great. So last episode, well, let's even back up before that. We've had a few episodes now discussing adaptive skills. I'm not going to spend really any time talking about what exactly adaptive skills are, but I would encourage all our listeners, if you're listening to this episode and you haven't listened to the adaptive skills episodes, go back and listen to those. This might make a little more sense. But giving feedback, receiving feedback, listening so others feel heard and respected, those are what we are calling the trifecta of adaptive skills. If managers, leaders, and really anybody, if they practice and hone those three skills, their life is going to be in a better place.
Absolutely. They're going to be more successful. They're going to impact people more positively. Their marriages and their relationships are going to be more positive. Yeah, I totally concur, buddy.
So last episode, we talked about the art, because it really is an art, of receiving feedback, how to do that so you're not showing up defensive,
mm-hmm.
so you can keep that channel of communication open between you and the person giving you feedback, so you can hear the truth, so you can grow and improve, so you can keep connected to that relationship. And today, we're going to look at the other side of that coin, which is the giving feedback.
Right. And I'll tell you what, if receiving feedback was an art, giving feedback is, what's a bigger word? A fine art?
A masterpiece.
A masterpiece.
Well, I mean, it's still art, I guess.
Yeah, it's not
a symphony.
There you go. It's not easy at all to give feedback in a way that, well, here's the principle, right? We want to give feedback in a way that at the same time you're telling your truth, you're also maintaining relationship. And I want to dig into that a little bit further because we talked about this before. When somebody receives feedback and they know they're receiving feedback and they know it's going to be not a piece of praise, it's not going to be a compliment, but it's going to be something corrective, you can't help when you're in that situation of receiving feedback, you can't help but feel some defensiveness. And we won't go into all that again. We talked about that a lot in the last couple episodes. But the basic idea is when you're about to get criticized, your amygdala feels fear. You can't help that. That's human. So you automatically feel defensive. Now, here's the thing. When you feel defensive, when you go into fight or flight, your sympathetic nervous system kicks in, and that alone makes it almost impossible for you to learn and develop and grow, right? So here we are. We're giving somebody feedback in a way that would make anyone defensive and then wonder why that person is being defensive and not open to our feedback. So the bottom line is this. We have to give feedback in a way that lowers the other person's defenses, and that's not easy.
Absolutely. Again, we made it here today because we're really good at responding to fear. Our brains haven't adapted. And so we're still using that part of the brain every day, even when we're not aware of it, right? So when our self-esteem is threatened, when our self-concept is threatened, when my social status is threatened, when rejection is a possibility, these are all the sorts of things our brains are always looking for.
Those are called threats.
They're called threats. And when one of those things feel threatened, we can't help but start pushing back. That's defensiveness. So today we're going to talk about mastering the art of giving feedback in a way that not only communicates clearly what you're trying to communicate, but lowers the other person's defenses,
yep.
Right? That's not easy because they will feel defensive. That's why it's an art.
That's exactly right. And the way we're going to do that today is we're going to talk about the art of giving feedback in three different chapters. And we may just cover two of these chapters possibly in this podcast. We may save the third chapter for our next podcast. It's a lot of information. But the idea is we're going to kind of do the sort of the 95 level pre-credit class first, which is about kind of what you want to do right up front, what you want to think about even before you begin. And then we're going to move into the 105 level class, which is the heart of the conversation. And then at the end, we're going to save this kind of master's level class where we're going to introduce to you the BIR acronym. It's the heart of what feedback is all about.
That sounds good to me. So should we just get this going?
Let's do it.
Should we start? So yeah. We're starting apparently with what you're calling the 95 level class.
Yeah, it's the kind of the pre-credit stuff. And what I mean by that is these are things that I'm almost a little embarrassed when we teach on these first things because I think everyone knows these things. But you know what? There's going to be a couple people out there that maybe hadn't thought of this. And so we just want to take a couple minutes and mention these real basic things you're going to want to be thinking about before you even give somebody feedback.
And I'll even push back on that a little bit of saying, honestly, when I was first learning this stuff, I didn't know this 95 level course stuff. Like some of these these things were kind of a little bit new to me. So right. Don't feel bad because you're right there with me, folks.
Okay. Well, let's do it. First thing, there's four things, basically. Four things I want people to be thinking about before they give the feedback. The first one is just called prepare. Don't shoot from the hip. Don't give feedback when you're pissed off. Don't think, well, I'm feeling this right now, so I'm just going to walk over there and give some feedback. And the reason, of course, is, well, let's go back to our principle. Giving feedback is an art, and we need to give feedback in a way that lowers the other person's defenses. And if you're just getting your own inner need met by spouting off what you want to say, you're meeting your need. You're not meeting the other person's need. And what's possibly, maybe even probably going to happen there is you're going to hurt trust and respect. You're going to cause defensiveness. You're going to cause fight or flight. You owe it to this person that you're just about to, let's say, criticize or give some corrective feedback to. Let's say it's your employee. You owe it to that employee to do this well. Because it does not feel good to get corrective feedback. So prepare. Think about it. Maybe even write a couple notes down, whatever.
So number one, think it through at least a little. Actually, this is one that's a little bit counterintuitive. Do I think some workplace cultures? I've been in a workplace culture of the, it's a quote unquote feedback culture,
yes.
Real-time feedback quote culture, which we were encouraged and even expected to. If you have feedback right then and there, boom, you drop it on them right then and there. There's no really thinking it through, at least a little, right? So again, this sounds like it's easy or simple or no-brainer, like duh, but that's not the case in some workplaces.
No, and Ethan, I'm glad you mentioned the feedback culture, because I've actually heard that before. I've been a consultant in organizations that have attempted to create a feedback culture. Now, we actually have that as one of our themes. We really do want to come in and help create a culture of feedback, but it isn't the Wild West. It isn't. It doesn't have that feel. And I've watched that.
Stick 'em up, partner. I got feedback for you.
Exactly. When you try to build a culture that's that sort of spontaneous, quote, authentic, in the moment, shoot from the hip feedback, you are only appealing, and this goes back to behavior styles, to about 30% of the population who actually can and can do that and can do it well and can take it well, but you are alienating and you are disenfranchising 70% of the population. It's a dangerous route to go down. Yes, create a culture of feedback, and we'll be talking about that here and there throughout the next several episodes, but not that way.
So the second one of the level one stuff for giving feedback is ask for permission, right? Now, this is as simple as, hey, can I talk to you about something, right? Do you mind if I give you some feedback on something I've been thinking about? So just ask for permission.
Yeah. This is a really simple one, and it's so simple, I think it confuses people. It's not even literally permission in some cases, right? Like if it's your employee, I guess technically, of course, you have permission to give feedback. That's your job. It's really a social skill that says, I'm not going to barge into your office and not even consider what phone call you've just hung up from or what's on your mind right now. It's allowing you to claim the space. If this is a good time, can we use this time? Now, I would suggest, only because the word has become loaded, maybe not even use the word feedback.
Right.
You know, hey, I have some feedback for you. Bam, there goes the amygdala, right?
Right.
Fear.
You know, what else could you say?
You might say, hey, you suck. Just kidding. No, you might want to say something
hey, I need to tell you something you're sucking at.
Yeah, you know what you, yeah. No, it's maybe something like, hey, can I talk to you for a second? Or I want to share something with you. Or, hey, I have an idea for you. I've been thinking about something. Do you have a couple minutes? I mean, it's close, but it's a little bit of a euphemism, but you might not want to use the word feedback just because that word itself has kind of become embedded in our sort of amygdala fear system at this point. So, but yeah, to ask permission, is this a good time?
Sure. When I was teaching this class talking about feedback with a group of mechanics from a large public utility, and I was talking about the asking permission piece, and a couple of them were like, wait, no, in our environment, we can't wait to ask permission. If somebody's doing something wrong that I need to give them a feedback on, if we wait to ask permission, they might get hurt. It's like, okay, well, let's be clear here. If it's a situation like a safety issue, yeah, maybe that's not the best time to go and ask for permission. That's the time when you just say, hey, you need to stop doing that. You're going to get hurt.
Yeah. In fact, what that reminds me of is that there's actually two kinds of feedback that we're not talking about today. Let's take a side trip real quick on that. The two kinds of feedback we're not talking about. Number one, we are not talking about emergency feedback at all. In fact, almost every guideline and strategy we're going to discuss today doesn't really apply to that bus is about to hit my child in the middle of the street. You know, get the hell out of the street. Oh, sorry, don't say that. But you know what I'm saying? So yeah, it's not about emergency stuff. It's also what we're not talking about right now is positive feedback. And it's, we are going to address it a little bit today, but it's not the heart of what we're talking about. Because what's really cool about positive feedback, you can almost break all these rules. And we're going to do a whole section on that coming up.
Okay. Giving feedback, think it through at least a little, ask for permission. And the third one is?
Third one is I'm just going to show you what it is. I'm not going to tell you, Ethan. I'm just going to do it to you. Ready?
Sounds good.
All right. Hey, Ethan. Hey, I got some feedback for you. Do you have a minute?
I suppose so.
Okay. Oh, shoot. I'm out of time. Well, you know what? You are really bad at this job. Hey, I got to go.
Well, not the first time I've heard that.
That's called no drive-by feedback, right? This is the person.
Now, that is called drive-by feedback.
Oh, yeah, what I just did. That's drive-by feedback, but the principle is don't do that. Right. This is the person who literally does not want to have a conversation with you. They just want to dump their feedback, and they want to be done. And obviously the other person is going to feel very defensive. They're probably going to feel resentful. They're probably going to write off the feedback because that's really unfair.
Right.
Right.
Honestly, it's just no way to treat another human being.
No, it's really not. Here's what I think. Okay, we're done talking. Goodbye is incredibly disrespectful. And so we're saying if you're going to give somebody feedback, then you yourself need to have plenty of time and actually have a conversation.
Sounds good. Number four is don't make them wait.
Ethan, I've got some feedback for you about something that's been really bothering me. Is that all right?
I guess so.
Okay. Well, you know what? Now is really not a good time. So how about next Friday at 4?
Wow. That's cruel.
Yeah, that's real cruel.
Because what is the person going to be doing during that gap of time?
Oh, yeah.
Freaking out.
Making stuff up. Right?
Now, I think last episode, you said that old Native American quote, when you give me a blank, I fill it in with demons.
Mm-hmm.
Well, hey, that sure applies here, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Someone's going to have to wait to hear the feedback. They're going to be thinking the worst possible things about what that feedback's going to be about.
Yep. Yeah, they're going to be not only making stuff up or coming up with the worst stories, they're going to be getting proactively defensive. Oh, if he says this, I'm going to say this, right? Now, there's another version of don't make people wait, right? The one we just did was, you know, I'm making you wait several days. Well, here's the other version of don't make people wait. It's, hey, Ethan, I've got some feedback for you. Is that all right?
That's all right.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you know what? Before I get into it, this is not going to feel good. Why don't you sit down? And you know what? Before I give you the feedback, I want to give you some backstory. And, you know, okay, before I mention what I'm bothered about, can I talk to you about this other thing that happened last week?
So just a super long runway.
Oh, it's the runway that just, you're just building up this anxiety. The other person, of course, is filling it in with all sorts of demons. You're literally giving them time for them to go into amygdala overload at that point, right? So you know, I don't mean come in and just cut to the chase in the first 3 seconds, but you know, be reasonable. Give the person a little bit of time to kind of get their head around where we're going and then just get to it.
Awesome. So that's the level one stuff. There are four things you should be doing basically before you give feedback, things you should be thinking about before you actually deliver the feedback, which is one, think it through at least a little.
Number two is to ask permission before you jump in.
Number three is no drive-by feedback. Yep. Give them time to respond and to talk about it.
And number four is don't make people wait.
All right. That is the 95-level course. You finally passed.
Awesome. That feels good.
Let's move on to the 105.
Yeah. This is the conversation itself. And I want to remind everybody about our I hate to use the word formula, but the method by which we improve our adaptive skills, right? There's internal work and there's external work, right? And internal and external. So there's the stuff we do in our brains, which has to do with our heart and our mind and our thoughts and our beliefs and our concepts. Then there's the stuff we do externally, which is the actual behaviors, right? So for this one, I want to take a couple minutes, this one meaning giving feedback well. Let's talk about the internal work, right? Let's take a couple minutes to talk about what you might be doing in your head to become better at giving feedback. Does that work?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right. So a couple things. One, we've already covered. Please remember that your goal is to lower the other person's defenses. I think if everybody planted that in their brains as they were giving feedback, it would change the way we see feedback in our world, right? I'm thinking now in terms of lowering your defenses. And that's pretty close to the second thing I want people to be thinking about, which is maintain relationship, right? Mm-hmm. People who feel trusted and respected are actually going to be much more likely to hear that feedback and hear it from the heart that it was intended from and incorporate it and listen to it, right? So build relationship. Here's another one. Assume good intent, right? Assume the other person is a good person. Assume that that person has the same goals in life that you do, which are things like, I want to be happy. I want to be successful. I don't want to fail. Let's assume the other person does not wake up in the morning and say, how can I fail today? Right? How can I be incompetent today? How can I make people feel bad today? That's just not what people are doing. So just assuming the best, assign good motives as opposed to assigning negative motives.
Mm-hmm. Now, you briefly touched on this with your goal really here is to lower the other person's defensive before giving feedback.
Right.
So you do need to have a relaxed tone, right? A relaxed body tone, relaxed speech, right? You have to engineer what you say. The best way to keep people from being defensive is through your tone and your body language. Giving the message of I am in your corner, because like you said, the bottom line here is your feedback should work, right? Your feedback should work, or else why else are you giving feedback?
Right.
If your goal is not to have that feedback work, then you should probably shut the hell up.
Right. Yeah. If your goal is to hurt somebody or make them feel bad or shock them into compliance or whatever, you are going to. Now, here's the thing. You may be successful, right? You may come at the person with a sarcastic or an angry or a frustrated tone. You may get compliance. You may get what you want in the moment. But the cost is relationship. The cost is trust and respect. And the cost is the possibility that they actually won't seriously consider your feedback. Now what you've done here is you've crossed from the internal to the external, right? So the internal work, right? Again, it's maintaining relationship, it's lowering their defenses, it's assigning good motives. Then we cross over now into the behaviors.
Mm-hmm,
and that's what you've just started introducing.
Yep,
right?
Yep.
The first behavior, as you just said, of course, is it's the way we show up physically and it's the way our tone sounds. And I you know what, at the risk of being redundant, let me say this again. When you have someone criticizing you, and let's just call it that, right? Somebody pointing out something that they wish you did differently or don't like about the way you're behaving, whatever, especially if there's a power differential, right? Now imagine this person is your boss. Add to that, they're angry. You cannot help but go into fight or flight. You just can't help it.
Yeah. It's gonna be really hard to hear what that person is actually trying to convey.
Yep.
If that person is angry, that person has a power differential over you. Good God.
Yeah. You're in threat mode. Your amygdala goes into threat mode, which means you literally have to protect yourself. And protecting yourself is exactly what defensiveness is, right?
Right.
So when you add frustration or anger to your voice when you're giving feedback, again, you might feel when you're doing it that, hey, this is going to be effective, right? Because if I don't sound mad, you know, he's not going to take me seriously. Well, that's not what's happening. When you're sounding mad or frustrated as you're giving feedback, you're moving that person into putting up their walls and to moving into fight or flight. Now, I used to do parent training, right? You know, my first career was social work. And I'd have parents in class who would say to me, hey, in our family, it's actually true. You know, you have to yell at the kids to get them to do anything. And it was sad when I heard that because I didn't disagree with them. That's probably true in their family. Problem is, those kids weren't born that way, right? They didn't come out needing to have anger in order for them to receive feedback, right? They acclimated to that in that family. So yeah, bottom line for this first piece of the behavior stuff is we watch our tone. We don't want to come across angry. Instead, we want to have a tone that says, I'm on your side. I'm for you, not against you. I'm in your corner. And you're going to have your own way of developing and conveying that tone. That's going to be your own personal style.
Right. So basically, we're talking about the do's and don'ts when actually giving the feedback here. So Here's another one. Don't give general feedback. Hey, Mike, you have really poor social skills.
Okay. So all of them? Like every single social skill
I
suck at?
Every single one, right? No, right? General feedback is dangerous because it makes the other person have to guess. And unfortunately, it's easy for us to give general feedback.
Mm-hmm.
I would say, going back to the big fear thing, partly because of fear. We really don't want to have to dial in with the person and directly confront the specific issue. So we just want to kind of leave it open, not offend people, hope they get the real message. But guess what? They rarely get the message when you just leave it open there. So don't give general feedback and do be specific.
Yeah, I can't tell you how many annual reviews I've seen that contain very general, high-level corrective feedback, so much so that the person reading this review cannot figure it out. They have to guess. And they're going to guess again. They're going to fill in the blank with demons, right? you don't run good staff meetings, right? Well, what does that mean? There's like 30 moving parts to a good staff meeting.
Yeah, or even worse, your staff meetings could improve.
Yeah, thanks.
Because it's like, okay, you're not even saying they're bad. They could improve, but can't everything kind of improve? So what are they saying here? Right. I'm freaking out.
And which one of the 30 parts of a good staff meeting am I lacking, right? And same thing with, and the one you just said to me is actually pretty funny. I actually saw a review that said that. It said, has poor social skills. This poor employee had a review and in the negative column was told he has poor social skills. Mm. What in the world is he supposed to do with that?
Not a whole lot.
Yeah. Other than get resentful.
Right. What else here? The do's and don'ts when giving the actual feedback.
All right. So we have body language and tone. We have don't be general, but instead be specific. Here's another one that I think is real important is you have to be pretty accurate with your language, right? Mm-hmm. As opposed to hyperbole, exaggeration. You know, hey, Ethan, what's the first thing you think? Ethan, you're always late.
No, I'm not always late.
Right.
Remember like that one Monday a couple months ago? I was on time.
Exactly. You're right.
You're wrong. You're a liar.
Yes. Yes.
I was on time.
That's exactly what happens. As soon
just
as
kidding. I'm never on time.
That's actually true. No, but as soon as I am not accurate, as soon as I exaggerate, I'm not telling the truth. I'm not meaning to lie. I'm probably trying to emphasize my point, right? I remember one time, it might have been you, Ethan, or your brother. I can't remember which one of you it was, but I said something like, when you mow the lawn, you don't mow back here by the dog kennel, which is I didn't even use the word never, right? But the implication, right? When you mow the lawn, you don't mow back behind the kennel. And you said, or it was your brother, I can't remember which, said, well, yes, I do. Remember that one time?
Right.
So you literally did exactly what we just role played here.
Exactly.
Right? So I didn't tell the truth. I exaggerated, which caused you, and here's what's going on there. You get to instantly reject my message at that point.
Right.
Because it's not true.
So it's just as best you can, you know, being precise with your speech, being precise with what you say.
Yeah. Things like, and it doesn't have to be super precise. You don't have to say 7 times last month, although you can, if you know that, but you could say sometimes.
Right.
You could say, occasionally.
Occasionally, once right. in a while.
Exactly.
So.
Great. Let's do another one.
All right. How about... Did we talk about don't do delayed feedback?
No, let's talk about that.
So delayed feedback. So what do you think when I say I have a problem with something that you did 8 months ago?
Oh, it instantly causes for me a couple things. First of all, I think to myself, how embarrassing is that? Right? Is it something that I've been doing for 8 months and I'm still doing it and you're allowing that to go on? That's embarrassing. But worse now, you've actually hurt trust between you and I. Now I'm thinking, oh, great. What else are you not going to tell me for 8 months? What else are you holding on to? Now I'm on this kind of shaky footing with you. I don't trust you to stay current. It hurts trust.
Okay. And how about this one? Give feedback in the right place, right? A place where that person is not going to be embarrassed. That's just something to keep in mind, right? I go back to the quote unquote feedback cultures that it's mm-hmm. like real time feedback. Hey, if you need to give someone feedback, it's right there in front of everybody. That would happen on a daily basis.
That's
just
terrible.
Someone basically getting put on blast in front of the entire office.
Yeah.
That's like, well, okay. Is that type of feedback actually going to work? Or are they just going to be so embarrassed? They might not even hear what you're saying because you're on blast. So,
yeah, no, absolutely. That the feedback has got to be private. And keep in mind that your definition and my definition of privacy might differ.
Right.
Mike, Christy, and I can go to a really crowded restaurant and I can talk to her about anything. And she's appalled because it does not feel private to her. And she wants to talk to me about something important or personal. It has to be in a very, a quiet place with nobody around. So our definition of privacy will vary. So I would say kind of go with the person who has the smallest boundaries, the biggest boundaries.
The person that has a smaller yes. boundary as far as comfort
right.
level,
right. Right. Right.
embarrassed
right.
level,
yep.
right?
Yeah. Here's one. This conversation should not be a monologue, right? This isn't a speech. This isn't a, you shut up and let me talk at you for 15 minutes kind of thing. For so many reasons, right? That it's condescending. It puts the person in sort of this long-term one-down position. It gives them all this time to get defensive. This should feel like a dialogue. This should feel like a conversation. This means that you're asking questions, you're listening super well, which we've talked about before, even during this conversation. It's a back and forth. I mean, again, we have to keep saying this. This is about relationship.
Right. And I'm just going to quickly jump back to some brain science here for a moment, right? One of the five things our brains are always searching for to make sure we're okay in our environment is a thing called status. So meaning that when we feel less than, or we are feeling like one down from you, and it's unconsciously happening, but again, our brains automatically will go to defensive mode. Mm. So when you add to this, you know, a lecture, when you're giving me feedback, the amygdala, remember the part that processes the fear, is going off. And we sometimes call this the amygdala takeover.
Mm-hmm.
And our status warning lights are flashing.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And so, and you can alleviate that some, you can mitigate that by basic things like respect and listening and asking and joining, right? This is the relationship piece, right? Mm-hmm. So one more in this category, and this is kind of a really big one, and it kind of harkens back to the story I told at the beginning of the podcast. I want to talk about, I think we should talk about adding some positive to this conversation. And again, we're going to talk about giving positive feedback in general as a standalone another time. So today, of course, we're talking about corrective feedback. But even in corrective feedback, Ethan, do you see a place for including something positive, to including an appreciation? Do you see a place for that while you're actually giving corrective feedback?
Yeah, I think there is a place for that as long as it's authentic. I think where it gets a little dicey is people try to do the feedback sandwich, which is actually how I originally learned to give feedback in a work environment. And I just think the feedback needs to fit, right? It needs to kind of match what you're giving negative feedback around, and it needs to be not just something that the person just was trying to find just so they could give negative feedback.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you think?
No, totally. When we talk about this in class, I'd like to give a couple principles around giving positive feedback. And one of them is exactly what you just said. It's like, hey, Ethan, hey, nice haircut. You're really bad at your job. You know, hey, nice shoes. Right? I mean, okay, there's a sandwich, right?
Right.
I came up with some stupid piece of feedback about your hair and about your shoes, which, by the way, your hair is nice. And
well, thank you.
Your shoes are lovely. But, you know, this sandwich thing, if it's not done with some skill, it really does sound stupid. It sounds phony. It sounds insincere. So here's the principle for that piece. It's your praise, your appreciation has to be in the same zip code as the thing you're giving the feedback about, right? It has to match in content and in seriousness, in topic. So for example, hey, I really like your staff meetings in this way. These are some things you're doing really well. And here's something I'd like you to work on in your staff meetings, right?
Right.
Hey, this report, good work. Really, you spent a lot of time on this. I like the way you organize these two sections. I like the reference page over here. This piece here, I'd like you to move to here and maybe fill out this a little more.
Okay.
So there's the positive and the negative fitting together. And it could even be a big zip code, right? Hey, here's three things that you're really doing well at work. These three areas you're really excelling. Here's something I'd like you to work on. So that's a big zip code, right?
So my question on that is, you know, what is the point of adding in the positive, I guess? I mean, you have feedback for them. And the reason why you're really going to talk with them is because you actually do need to give them some negative feedback. So by adding in the positive, doesn't that seem a little bit disingenuous?
Well, no. And that kind of gets us to our second principle about positive, right? So the first principle, of course, is keep it in the same zip code, right? The second principle is if you're not in the habit of giving positive feedback anyways, right? If you're not in the habit of noticing good all by itself, standalone, right? If you're not in the habit of showing appreciation and you never do that, and now all of a sudden you're going to start adding a positive before you do a negative, you're going to be exactly like my boss.
Exactly.
That I told you about in the beginning of the show. It's
right.
Going to sound exactly like what it is, which is, oh, I have to give some negative feedback. I better come up with something positive.
Right.
So really what's going to happen at that point when you give the positive, it's going to hurt.
Right.
It's going to be scary.
It's like, oh, here comes the bomb.
Yeah. So the only way this works, now kind of back to what you asked, is it helpful? Absolutely. Right. People, when they hear something positive, if they believe it's sincere, right? And that's the key. It feels right. It feels like you're being fair. You're seeing both. You're seeing the good and the bad. You're not just criticizing. There's something about the way we've evolved that we need positive. There's a whole lot of reasons for that, which we'll talk about in another podcast. But I really do believe that starting with a compliment or some kind of a praise or some appreciation is a really good idea. Again, if it fits into the same zip code and it doesn't feel like that's the only time you give positives.
Right. Right. Right.
There is a certain behavior style, which we'll talk about another day. They tend to be the honey, I told you I loved you when I married you. I'll let you know if I change my mind person. Do we need to keep rehashing this? If that's you, right? If you're out there, if you're the person who never gives compliments, please don't start practicing compliments right before a negative. Right. Practice the compliments separately.
Right.
And I don't mean like my boss, like 3 hours separate. I mean,
right.
Like really separately.
That was very strategic.
Yeah. Very, very strategic.
Right. Okay. So the concept there is you should be giving positive feedback, or when you give negative feedback and you try to mix in the positive, it won't come across as serious. Like it's not genuine.
Absolutely. Yeah. Right? And yeah. So it has to be in the same zip code. It has to be sincere. It has to not be the first time you've given, you know, a positive. Another thing is don't ruin it with the word but.
Yeah, right. Because right. That negates everything you just said before.
Yeah. Hey, I really like your staff meetings. I like when you do this, but you need to change this. Okay. The word but right there just wiped out what you just said.
Okay.
So instead, what do you do? What word can you replace with?
You can put an and in there. Yep. Or you could just cut out the conjunction altogether, just put a complete stop, a period, and then continue with what you're saying.
I like that one a lot. Yeah. I like the and a lot, but I like this full stop. I like the, hey, I really like this report and you've done really good work here. And I like the way this is. Good job on that. I'd like you to work on this, right? Fix this over here. Okay. I like that first compliment was a standalone.
Yeah. So do I. So, you know, I think you all can tell we're not a big fan of what somebody in a class last week called the shit sandwich.
Oh, they did. I remember right. That.
Yeah, no, the positive, then the shit in the middle, and then a positive again. You don't need to do that, right? You all get it. Well, I know there's some more stuff as far as things to do and don't do during giving the feedback, but I think at this point we can probably just move on to the graduate level course. This is the more complicated part of giving feedback. But, folks, we're at about 40 minutes on this episode, so you all are going to have to wait for next time. On our next episode, we're going to cover the graduate level course of giving feedback, which just briefly involves the BIR that you mentioned at the beginning of this show.
Yeah, it's the stuff that, I mean, we've been talking about what to think about beforehand. We've been talking about the actual content. What we're going to move into in our next episode is what's really the topic of our feedback. What can we give feedback about and what can we absolutely not give feedback about?
I'm excited for that one.
Yeah, you want to wrap up with some wrap-up stuff here?
Yeah. Just real quickly, please, please, please email me your questions that you would like us to answer on the show. We're actually going to have a Q&A episode coming up here in just a few weeks. Additionally, if you just have topics that you would like to see us cover or situations you're dealing with in the workplace, email me what you have. Email Ethan at NashConsulting.com. In case you don't know how to spell my name, that is Ethan at NashConsulting.com. Also, go to our website. It'll give you information on our upcoming leadership retreat, some of our services. Besides that, do you have anything else you want to add?
No, dude. And I do have some feedback for you, though, but I'm going to wait till next week, all right?
Use. SOB. Thank you.